devotion and steadfastness. We do not know how things happen in the scheme of life. I really thank you for being here this morning, for making it convenient to be here this morning, which I hope and sincerely trust with prayers to Bhagwan to make it on a regular basis. As I told you, brothers and sisters, we need to be a little more concentrated. We need to be a little more serious on Sai teachings. Application in our daily life. Take to spiritual sadhana. Besides talking about our own experiences and miracles, we are not underestimating miracles. We are not questioning experiences. But an experience and a miracle has got a message to convey. It has got a purpose to fulfill. It has a direction along which we are expected to tread towards the fulfillment of our spiritual goals. Therefore, the Thursday talks here would be more spiritual, more philosophical, will be more diving into the depths of the reality than superficial expressions of personal experiences. But at the same time, to make these sessions interesting, I also welcome you to talk to us now and then, how we have come to Swami, what kind of transformation has taken in your lives, and how you have taken to spiritual sadhana, and what we want to be, what we want to become, what we were, what we are, and what we aim to be. This is more or less an assessment or evaluation or self-audit, what we are, where we are. I would also request you to give your suggestions, your comments, whatever you feel from your heart. Kindly feel free, no reservation, no sevadar will pull you back. Nobody will ask you to leave this place. Nobody will force you. No reservation. Kindly have that love, that kinship of Sai bondage, of Sai relationship, which is unconditional. So kindly feel free and open to say whatever you feel about it. Just I will leave few thoughts for your consideration to ponder over and to meditate upon. There is every need to direct, to divert our perspective from the normal today. The reason is Baba has been inspiring us, being in his physical frame, physical form, till now. But today, we have to take a different turn, a different direction altogether. Tap water from outside, Baba being the divine tap, the water being the bliss, the bucket being our heart. Our heart is the bucket, the water is the bliss, available to us, freely flowing through the divine tap of Bhagwan outside till now. But from on, the tap is not there to draw water.
Tap is not there to open. Tap is not there to close. What shall we do now? Our pilgrimage, our spiritual practice from now on is drawing water out of the well. Drawing water out of the well is different from filling the bucket, drawing water out of the tap. Well is inside. We have to draw this water from within. That's what we have to do from now on. This is possible by being slow, by being steady, by being calm, by being composed, by being equanimous, less emotional and more balanced. Emotion will not take us anywhere. Emotion may take to the peaks at one time and may push us into the valley later. But the balanced state of mind is the ultimate reality, is the ultimate goal in spiritual practice. Let me be very clear, my friends. Swami wants us to take us to a higher level of spirituality today. I am not speaking anything from my dreams. I am not speaking anything based on my assumptions, presumptions, imaginations, hallucination. I am drawing from His own divine discourses. Whatever I speak, wherever I speak, are nothing but from Swami's discourses only. So Swami wants us to go to a higher level from now on. What is higher level? We are already in one form or other introduced into the spiritual discipline by the grace of Bhagwan Baba. His grace is in abundance, is so merciful that has drawn us into His presence all these years. In other words, we are not here on our own. We are here being selected by Him, being chosen by Him, being opted by Him. We are not here on our own. But I want to impress upon you, my friends, when He brought us here, when we are here, what has He done? What has He done? Did He say anything to you? Did He say anything to me personally? What has He done? What He has done is, He has sown the seeds of wisdom. He has sown the seeds of wisdom in the soil, in the field of our heart. Our heart is the field in which He has sown the seeds of wisdom. Shall we allow the seeds remain as seeds forever and ever? If a seed remains a seed forever and ever, it is useless. The seed gets decayed. The seed gets disintegrated. The job of the seed is to grow. The seed of wisdom has to germinate, has to sprout into a plant, into a sapling. It has to bear flowers. For what is it we are supposed to do? Water the seed, manure the seed, let the sapling grow, let us protect that sapling, young tender plant, such that it grows more and more and starts bearing flowers, and the flowers spread fragrance to everybody, fragrance to everybody. The flower natural cannot keep the fragrance to itself. It spreads. Similarly, my friends, we are grateful to the divine gardener, the divine farmer, Bhagavan Sri Satyasai Baba. He is a divine farmer, he is a divine peasant, he is a divine agriculturist, he is a divine seed grower, and he is a gardener, and he has sown the seeds of wisdom in our hearts. That he has done. He'll feel so sorry if we allow the seeds remain as seeds forever and ever. It is really pitiable if we allow them like that. We have to water it. We have to manure it. We have to see that it flowers. That is our duty now. What is that manuring? What is that watering? That is nothing but our meditation, our regular satsang. Regular satsang is manuring. Meditation is watering, so that the seed of wisdom would grow further and further, and bearing the fruits of spirituality, bearing the flowers of religion, the fragrance of bliss. That is the job that we have to undertake right now. Thanking Swami for selecting our hearts as the field to sow the seeds. Bhagwan, we promise that we'll certainly nurture, take care of, water, manure the seeds. We also have another responsibility. When the cloud is full of water, the cloud cannot remain like that. The cloud rains, the cloud showers. Likewise, when once I'm benefited, when once I'm profited by Bhagwan, it's my duty to share with everybody. That sharing is satsang. The satsang that we have is a sharing. What is the sharing? Something like the cloud that showers when it is full of water. When we are happy with the water of bliss, we have to shower, meaning share with our friends and in the neighborhood. Therefore, the waterfalls, Niagara waterfalls, the waterfalls from the top. So the cup of our heart cannot contain all the water of bliss. It spills out, it spills out, it pours out. So a container is small, fill it with water, full. More water, it spills out. Similarly, our cups are so small, full to the brim with the divine bliss. It flows out now. That's what satsang is. Satsang is overflowing of bliss from the heart, the cup of heart. The bliss is the nectar contained within the heart, which is filled with this divine grace. So we are sharing that nectar with everybody. That is overspilling from the cups of our heart. We are just spreading what we have, so that each one teach one, each one learn one, each one gain one. That's what it is. Satsang is most important in the field of spirituality. Baba often tells us one very important thing, my friends. Translating his talks for 22 long years, the maximum number of talks I translated. But practical experience, zero, 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 zero. I cannot say that I experienced the Self. I cannot say I have experienced the Cosmic Self. I cannot say that I had non-dual experience. I cannot say I have the glimpses and the taste of supreme bliss. I cannot say that. What has made me all these 22 years is to know what He meant, to communicate what He desires, to share with everyone what He has taught me. So in this field of sadhana, you and I are same. You and I are uniform. You and I are one, that's all. We are all the beginners. We are all the beginners. Unfortunately, some of us decided to begin after 70. Some have decided to begin after 75. While many do not know whether to begin or not. We are happy, at least we know that it is time to begin. We are happy, at least we know what we do not know. Many people do not know what they do not know. Because of His grace, we have come to know what we do not know. We know how far we have traveled. We also know how much more to travel, to what extent we reached, and where the destination is. Therefore, it is in the direction. Here, this is more or less a spiritual lab. This is a spiritual laboratory. This is not any public discourse. This is not to gain popularity. This is not to have any publicity. This is not meant for any propaganda. This is a travel all alone. Each one travels for one's own self. We travel, but as we travel, we have fellow travelers along with us so that we feel encouraged. To walk short distance alone, we get tired soon, don't we? But in a group, as we walk, we don't feel tiresomeness. We don't feel exhausted. We can walk long distances in a company. Likewise, satsang, this spiritual laboratory, is a place where we work together, we sing together, we meditate together, we share together, we learn from each other, we travel together towards the destination. That is the purpose for which the Thursday sessions have been commenced, with the divine prompting of Bhagwan Sri Satsai Baba. Most strangely enough, last night around 10 o'clock, when I am trying to make some notes, usually we teachers put the date on the top of every sheet. When I was putting the date, 2012 is this day at the commencement of our spiritual laboratory. 2-2-2012. If you just sum up the numbers, it would come to 9. So number 9 is divine. 2-2-2012 is again a miracle which we have not thought of. Some devotees are even sentimental of their number. Long back, it was in 1988, we had Silver Jubilee celebrations of Sri Satya Sai organization. That I remember very much. Anything worth remembering personally next to that date is 2-2-2012. 2012. This is worth remembering because this is going to be a milestone in our spiritual life. Well, all our pursuits, all our spiritual practice, all the 64 volumes of Baba can be summed up in one sentence. I may speak for hours, I may speak for days, I may read any number of books, but all that he said can be summed up in one sentence. What is it? Experiencing the self. Experiencing the self. Know what I am. Who am I? That's all. All the other stuff is towards this point only. Who are you? Who am I? What is that self? When that self is known, nothing needs to be known thereafter. As Baba says, 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 is equal to 9. If 1 is known, 9 can be known. If 1 is not there, 9 is out of question. That 1 is the self. 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 is equal to 9. So in the 9, all these 1, 1, 1 are there, totaled, added. So this 1 is the self. So when once I know the self, the rest are known, as Baba said. So our aim is to know that one, that self. We have been knowing everything. Somebody say, oh, I read so many books on who am I. Good. Yes, who am I? Though many saints, many seers, many spiritual aspirants, deep religious people have put a question to themselves, who am I? They could not get answer, while I say I got the answer. It is really ridiculous. It's not so easy to know who am I. We are not so easy. I can know who you are. I can know everyone, but I do not know myself. So I don't know. To quote Baba here, the eye and the ear are so near, do not see each other. Do not see each other. So the self is in me, but I do not know that. Further, Baba gives an example. With the help of 2 inches eye, we can see the stars, the moon and the sun, the whole galaxy you can see with the small eye, but the eye cannot see itself. My eye cannot see itself, but my eye can see you. Similarly, we are able to see everything, but we are not able to see ourselves. We are not able to know the real Supreme Self. It is so mysterious. It is so peculiar. It is so strange. So the job into which we have to get into, according to divine teaching, is to know the self, to experience the self. Why? When once you have experience of the self, we will know that self is the only reality, nothing else. Nothing else. That is only reality. All of us have same self, nothing new. Therefore, when self is known, nothing needs to be known. That's the reason why Baba expresses in every talk about the self. But we remember everything else, forget this self. Because we the householders, we the family people, we have got our own desires, we have got our own limitations, we have our own physical afflictions, complaints, the joint pains and cataract and spondylitis. They engage us continuously. the engages. The moment I sit for meditation, my joint pains appear, but not Baba. When I sit for bhajan and close my eyes, my spondylitis wants me to put the collar, but not concentrate on Baba. Therefore, my friends, these are all things that will pull us behind, pull us down, will not allow us to go higher and higher, up, up and up, because of these personal problems. There is one anecdote which I want to draw your attention. It seems a lover came to see his beloved. What he did was, he tapped the door, and there came a question. Who is there? Who is there? This man says, I am here. Then the reply comes, sorry, there is no place for two, I and thou. I and thou, or I and you. There is no place for two here. I'm sorry. This man understood, left the place. He sat in meditation. He did prayers for a long time and returned once again. The question, who is there? The answer is, it is thou. It is thou, meaning it is you. This is a religion. To say I is materialism. To say I is worldly. To say I is individualistic. To say I is self-centeredness. To say I is narrow experience. To say I is the beginning in religious field. To say thou, yes, essence of all religions, thou. Then this man thought, there is some other level. He went and prayed and returned. This time tapped the door. Who is there? He didn't reply. Then the door is opened. It only means there is no question of I and thou. No I, no you, only being, only existence, only divinity, only reality, no I and thou. If I say I and thou, it is duality. I and you, duality. When you don't say I, there is no question of you. There is only being. That's only existence. So the experience of this existence, the experience of this oneness, is the purpose of all religions. It is the quintessence of Bhagavan's, Baba's discourses. For this, what shall we do, my friends? What shall I do? The very funny thing that we do, it's common. Whatever statement I make, it includes me. And you can think I am number one among the ignorant. I am number one among the gang of foolish people. Yes. I am not sitting on a higher pedestal. Please come in, sir. We are all one. We are all one. It is in this field, I am telling you. Water bubble and ocean. Water bubble and ocean are two. Am I right? Water bubble and ocean are two. But on inquiry, in close investigation, on close scrutiny, on close observation, we will understand bubble and ocean are same. Bubble is not different from ocean. Bubble is same as ocean. Self is the supreme self. Self is the cosmic self. Self is universal self. That self is omniscient, omnipresent, omnipotent, immortal, nectarous. That self has no beginning. That self has no end. But I am afraid of the end of my life. I am afraid of incidents, accidents in my life. I am afraid of people around. I am frightened by circumstances. All this happens because we identify ourselves with personality. Personality. Personality means what? The body, mind and intellect. These three mean the personality. Body, mind and intellect. Body always wants comforts, conveniences. Ice creams, hot cup of coffee. It demands pizza, milkshake, hamburger, cheese, why not? Hot tea, yes? Hot pickles too, oh good. He reminds me, yes? It works. The body is like that. You are perfectly right, my brother. So the body demands. It has its own preferences. It has its own likes and dislikes. That is the first component of personality. The second component of personality is the mind. This mind is ego. This wants recognition. It fishes for compliments. It wants only praises. It wants everybody to certify, approve, acknowledge, agree. It does not accept any disagreement. It does not accept any comment. It does not entertain any criticism. So mind is egoistic, the second component of human personality. In the dynamics of human personality, the first component is the body. The second component is the mind. And the third component is intellect. What is this intellect? The intellect meaning that I can judge, I can decide, I can discriminate. This sense of discrimination, this sense of judgment, this sense of complex, this sense of self-pride, self-assurance is intellectual, the third component of human dynamics. These three constitute our personality. So long we think of our personality, the body, mind and intellect, we are surrounded by fear, constant fear. Body, I am fine, but tomorrow, if there is some day, I may have joint pains tomorrow. Body doesn't want it. I am so nice today, tomorrow if I turn bald, nobody would look at me. If there are wrinkles on my face, everybody will avoid me. If I am not dressed properly, Sevadar may not give me seat in the first row. First row. So, I am afraid. The body is full of suspicions. The body is full of fear. If I get up at 3 o'clock in the morning, what would happen? Some dog may chase me. Body is like that. I may get a cushion to sit on or not. I may get a chair or not. The body is always in constant fear. Mind is the other name of fear. Nobody's mind is at rest. The mind of everybody is restless. Children are married. Bank accounts are tolerably good. Accommodation is enough to live. Digestive capacity is better than the age demands. Yet mind is worried. Why? It's because he wants that his son should perform his daughter's marriage. How are you bothered? That fellow may perform or may not. Our daughter may have her own way of life. Who are you to decide? I am worried of my grandchildren, worried of my daughters-in-law, worried of my sons-in-law. This constant worry of the future makes my mind frightened. Mind lives in constant fear. Well, I have 5 lakhs of rupees in the bank account. Will it be enough if I am hospitalized? Why do you think that you will be hospitalized? First of all, why should you be hospitalized at all? No, that's the point. Suddenly if anything happens, who will take care of me if I fall sick after 10 years? Where is the guarantee you live for 10 years? In 10 minutes, there may be national anthem and vote of thanks. Who can say that? So the mind is never fearless. Mind is always restless. It likes to complain, you know that? When everything is comfortable, but still mind is uncomfortable. Why? It wants something else other than what it has. Mind is uncomfortable, very uncomfortable. Why? Because it wants something else other than what it has. When I have a small house, the mind will say, why not a big house? When I have a big house, the mind will say, can you manage it? When you are in the midst of many people, your mind will say, horrible, terrible, I have no personal time. I have no personal space. When you are alone, I am lonely. When you are alone, you are lonely. In a company, you are noisy. In a spacious house, you cannot maintain. In a small house, insufficient. What do you want? Let me know. It's not my mistake. It's not your mistake. It is a mistake of the mind, bloody mind, I tell you. It is really making us, our life, a monkey. That's what Baba says. Mind is a mad monkey. Mind is a mad monkey. It always wants to complain. It likes to feel discontented, dissatisfied. How many people you come across who say, I am fine? How are you? Getting on. What? Getting on? Pulling on. Or so-so. Or something. Or something. Anyhow, the life is coming to a close. Somebody will say, waiting for the last day. How silly it is, my friends, how silly it is. It only means frustration. It only means hopelessness. It only means depression. It only means lackluster stage. Have we lost the taste of life? Because the mind is like that. It will not allow us to be comfortable. It will not allow to relax. It goes on complaining. It is highly restless. That is the second component in the human dynamics. So I cannot satisfy my body. as Baba says, loading, unloading, loading, unloading. I cannot satisfy. You are not final. What I think may be correct, may be wrong according to you. What you feel correct may be wrong according to me. No one is final in their intellectual decision making. So all these three in human dynamics are making our life burdensome and heavy. Philosophy, the spirituality, is meant to go deeper and deeper into the personality. That which centers around personality, BMI, body, mind and intellect, are social sciences, are technical sciences, or psychology, humanities, to go deeper into the personality, deeper, not body, not mind, not intellect, still deeper and deeper, to the undercurrent, where there is spring of water. That's what is called the self. The self is at the bottom. To dive deep into the self, to go into the inner depths of personality is what religion is. But we have forgotten this fact, and we limit religion to time between 4 and 5 in the morning, between 6 to 7. Therefore, my friends, body has time, date of birth, date of departure. Mind has a time. It is waking state, sleeping state, dreaming. Intellect has time. It may not function also. But the self is timeless. Self is timeless. Self is formless. Self is nameless. Body has a name. Mind has a degree. Yes, I am MA. I am MSA. I am a graduate. I am a postgraduate. Yes, mind has qualifications. Mind has an identity. Intellect has got its own recognition. But self has no recognition. It has no identity. It has no name. It has no form. Why? Because the self is the one without the second. Self is the one without the second. Body is not the one without second. Your body is there. My mind is not without second. You have your own mind. My intellect is not the one without the second. You have got your own intellect. But the self in me is same in everybody. The purpose of religion, the purpose of philosophy, is to dive into the deeper depths of human personality, to know the self, to experience the self, and that self is supreme. That self is aim. That self is purpose. That self is the goal. That self is the end. What shall I do for that? What shall I do? To improve my health, what shall I do? Some exercises. To improve my marks, scores, grades in the school and colleges, what should I do? Study more. To have my sharp intellect, what should I do? Some concentration, some more contemplation, some more focused attention will make me intellectually sharp. So these three levels you can do. You can do to improve your health. You can do it to improve your thought. You can do to improve your intellectual caliber. But what do you do to know the self? What shall I do to know the self? Can I improve the self? What is there to improve upon? What shall I do? My friends, a process of non-doing, non-doing or not doing, is to know the Self. Stop doing, then you are the Self. Yes? It may look ridiculous. It may look very funny. I can tell you, go around Ganesha 100 times, very easy. You can know the Self. At all, body, like a bull, goes around these things. It disciplines you. It disciplines you, good for health also. Prescribed for physical exercise and for relief of the joint pains, but not the Self. So, the Self is a timeless. You don't need to do. Somebody asked, why do you say, I don't need to do? Why? The answer is, to know yourself, what should you do? If I am to do something, I should do that which is present at a different place, which is not here. I must do physical exercise. 10 minutes to go to gym, 15 minutes to swim. So, distance is there, time is there, effort is there in all these physical exercises. But to know the Self, where is the time? To know that I am Anil Kumar, how much time I need? If I tell you, please wait for 10 minutes, I will know whether I am Anil Kumar or not. What will you say? You should have told us yesterday itself. And would have saved our time. Is a wasting time like this? You should have told me like that. Is it not? To know me, how much time I want. To reach me, how many aircraft should I change? Frankfurt aircraft should I change? Or Bombay International? Collect the luggage, baggage, go to the next aircraft. A direct flight, yes. So, shall I go there? In going, in reaching, there is distance. In reaching, there is distance. In attaining, there is effort. In attainment, there is effort. In reaching, there is distance. In effort and distance, there is a time. These three are necessary. Effort, time, distance. These three are basic requirements for all our achievements, for all our accomplishments in this world. But for the Self, what is the time? Timeless. What is the effort? Effortless. What is the distance? Distanceless. So, distancelessness, non-doing, timeless, nameless, eternal. Who you are is known by the path of enquiry, what we call meditation. The purpose of meditation is to know that nameless, timeless, formless, attributeless, the one without a beginning nor an end, the non-dual, nectarine, ever effulgent, ever brilliant, ever radiant, resplendent, Supreme Self. That is meditation. In meditation, if you get some, say, Anil Kumar, I sat for a day meditation, I dreamt you. I saw you, somebody tell me. I tell them, you don't have to sit for meditation to see me. I'm here, you can open your eyes. Some say in meditation, I feel some pictures appearing in front of me. You can go to any Photoshop and see any number of pictures. Some feel, I feel very light in meditation. Get into the lift, you are very light. This is all. I'm not condemning. I'm not making fun of it. It is all a beginning. It's all a beginning. Because I'm trying to travel. I'm making a beginning for a long flight, for a long journey. So, for that long journey, these things naturally come in between. Feeling something special, feeling elevated, feeling light, some pictures appearing, somebody appearing. This Raj interested. Then you go to a state when you do not exist. Supposing if I say, what have you seen in meditation? I have seen is not meditation. Because I is there. So long I is there, it is not meditation. Some people say, I in meditation, to me, what happens? Meet next life, not now. I meditate, I have come to a wrong person. I'll tell you what happens in meditation. I'm sorry, nothing happens. Nothing happens. Because everything that happens, meaning what? It is not happening now. It will happen, meaning it is not at present. Then time. God is timeless. So meditation is not a happening. Meditation is not futuristic. It is not a hope. It is not a promise. It is a reality of your own. Then who is to know whom? I can know you. You can know me. In spirituality, I know myself. I know myself. If I know you, that is knowledge. If I know myself, it is religion. To know one's own self is religion. To know others is material sciences, is material social sciences. Therefore, our attempt is to go to this timeless, changeless, eternal, immortal self, which is certainly a long journey. I am sorry if I have taken more time than necessary. It is 11:30, I believe. And if I cross for more than an hour, I am afraid that you may think twice to attend the next session. I don't do that. I don't do that. So, we'll go slow. We'll go slow. And now, just for a couple of minutes, if you have anything to comment, if anything to say, if you have anything to add, if you have anything to suggest, if you have anything to change the format, anything to say on our Thursday satsangs, you are most welcome. Please, kindly feel free. Yes. Take this. చెప్పిస్తాను చెప్పిస్తాను
చెప్పండి.
వెరీ గుడ్. సర్వీస్ ఈజ్ టేకెన్ అప్ to forget one's own identity. When I am serving, I forget my ego. I am non-entity, I am serving you, I am serving God. So the purpose of service is a process of non-identity. That is a path, karma yoga, the path of action.